into what he says. He made it very clear that the evil of the world, as sin is often referred to, is the direct cry of Satan's presence in the world. He is alive. He is well. And the devil, or Lucifer, however we want to call him, the father of evil, who are always trying to tempt us. And one of the profound things that the Holy Father reminded us of has to do with the fact that although we have been baptized in Christ, where our sins were washed clean, there is still in our soul a certain susceptibility that if we are not careful, we can easily fall into sin. And today's message teaches us to demonstrate to us the truth of God. Every 3 years, we encounter this particular gospel proclamation, where Jesus gives us not one, not two, but three parables. And in the Hebrew numerology, three, like seven, are perfect numbers. And so the message that he's trying to convey to us has to be a very powerful message, because he is using three different parables. As you heard the proclamation, did you notice there is a subtle difference in the attitude and reaction of Christ, of God, in each of these gospels? Did you notice? Consider it is worthy of recounting it, of bringing it back in your conscious mind. The God and Christ in the Good Shepherd parable and in the widow's parable does not react in the same manner that the Christ in the prodigal son. She's a child of God, and this is her own. Yeah, thank you. You know, I'm really talking about that here today, because when God sees us, trust me, he doesn't know if I got here or not. He doesn't know if I'm white, red, yellow, brown, black. He doesn't care. The only thing he sees in each and every single one of us is his son, our Lord Jesus Christ. So that child is Christ, and this is home. So don't take her out. And here's the clincher in the stories. In the Good Shepherd and the widow, the God that we see is a God who goes out in search of, not necessarily what has been lost, rather what has been misplaced, what has gone astray. He knows that if he goes out in search of, he will find the sheep. He knows that by involving the family, the community of faithful, the widow will be taken care of. Because the last point, which is her only means of survival, will be found. And that is why there is enormous rejoicing. When that which was God's faith or being misplaced is found. You see, especially when it comes to the great shepherd story. Why? Jesus is a lousy accountant. You know, he leaves 99 to go for the one. In business, never unacceptable accounting practice. Unaccountable thinking that business loss, best judgment, and that she would have been history. Thankfully, that Christ doesn't think like that. Thankfully, because I or any one of you could be a lost sheep. And it is also reassuring that the love and the depth of Christ is such that he will go to search for us. He will go and do whatever needs to be done to find us. And he will rejoice when he finds us and brings us to the safety of his bosom, where we are made in you. That will be more. That will be. Don't forget it. So, he's thinking. And you don't remember what he was like, but that's what he's like. It hurts. So, that is critical for us to understand. Now we come to the parable of the prodigal son. And now we see a totally different approach by the Lord of God. Now we see a God who respects our exercise of free will and life. Now we see a God of patience and a God of persevering. Now we see a God that when he gets the smallest glimpse of our repentance, he just doesn't wait until we come to him. He goes out. He goes out to meet us. And not walking leisurely, he runs. He runs to meet the dead son who has now come back to life. Because the life of perdition that was being led by the prodigal son was a life of certain death. But when the father sees that little glimpse of repentance in his soul, in his heart, in his mind, in the fiber of his beings, he runs. Followed by emphasizing the fact that he runs. Because in Jewish culture, during Jesus' time, it was totally improper conduct for a man of the stature and dignity that is being represented in the father, in the parable of the prodigal son, to a man. He's a man of enormous need. He's a man of enormous influence in the community. It would be beyond him to just run. He would leisurely and majestically come to his son or wait for his son to come to him. But our soul with our God, our God doesn't care about those things. Our God cares about us. Our God cares about how much he loves us and how much he wants us to love him. By loving one another. And that is the difference in these three parable stories. My brothers and sisters in Christ, we need to open our hearts in this year of mercy. And we need to look inside
for us all. When we come together as a family of Christ in this holy temple of this, I tell you, He only sees a Jesus hijo, little Jesus. In the diminutive, He only sees through the eyes of a tender Father, through the eyes of a loving Father, who looks for the best there is in all of us. We could be grumpy, old, and sinful, and if He sees the glimpse of repentance in our heart, He sees His Son shining forth in us. How can God the Father say no to our Lord Jesus Christ? How can God the Father, after all the sacrifice of His only begotten Son on the altar of life that is the cross, how can He not say to us who Jesus loves, how can He not also love us? My brothers and sisters in Christ, be not afraid to come to the living waters of the Lord. Be not afraid to approach the well of Sychar, the very well where the Samaritan woman washed away and cleaned her sinfulness, acknowledging her truth and giving it to the Lord our God. It is time before the year of mercy runs out for us that we come before the Father with a repentant heart, thus to receive the irresistible love and grace that the Father desires to give to each and every single one of us. God bless you.